Schönen guten Abend. Ich bin sehr erfreut, dass so viele gekommen sind, trotz des schönen Wetters, und werden natürlich jetzt switchen into English. One of our participants said that maybe she switches from English into German if she doesn't remember the word well, but we will try to mix it and to have a good dialogue. First of all, I want to thank the Ukrainian group that we have the possibility to come here to have a discussion. There's also a list, I think, if you want to have an invitation, and you are not a usual participant at the discussions here, please use it. They always have very good and interesting discussions and presentations. Hopefully, as today or tonight. Now, we who organize that, we are, as it's called, Platform for Dialogue and Conflict Resolution in Ukraine. Maybe it's not necessary. We are a platform of individuals and institutions from different sectors, political, culture, whatever, because we think that also in times of crisis, one should talk to each other from the different sides. We just had a discussion to define who are the sides. You will hear anything about it, because the victims are not the politicians who have the quarrel, but the victims are citizens who are prevented to come to the other side, to visit their relatives, to get their pension, to get to their jobs. And that was the basic idea that Austria, especially in times of OSCE presidency, but also in other times, should be a bit active. We know that the foreign minister is active. We are totally independent. We are private citizens who think, let's also start some dialogue. Cultural dialogue, political dialogue, economic dialogue, in order to do our bit of a mosaic of people who think we just cannot accept that the crisis is at the heart of Europe. People are killing each other. People are preventing a good life from each other. And that is not very far away from Vienna. So that is the basic idea of our initiative. Today we have one of the discussions. We plan, of course, more activities, not just discussions, but really bringing people together. I'm very happy that we have an interesting podium with us. Again, it's a dialogue also with you, so we want to prevent monologues, because that's enough we have of them in this world. Now, I would welcome our guests, and perhaps in the order they will speak, as we just agreed. First of all, Gudrun Gusel, manager of foreign aid Caritas Vienna. She just came back from Kiev. Of course, she has visited also the front line. She's very active together with Caritas, and maybe she can present the latest view from her side. Then we have Roman Koval, mediator and director of the Institute for Peace and Common Ground in Kiev. Welcome and thank you for coming. It's very good to have you here. And we want to extend, of course, a cooperation with you. Then we have YEVGENIA BELORUSETS, an artist. We thought it would be important to have also the point of view of an artist, what she can do, what she can say, how she does interpret, because maybe she's going beyond the normal political hick-hack, and we would say the political divisions between the one or the other side. That does not mean that he doesn't have an opinion. We just heard some of it, and I think it would be very interesting. And then we have Oliver Vujovic, who just came from Belgrade, where he has been for one day. So he's one of the people who do 613 kilometers in 4 hours, 4.5 hours. Not by plane, but by car. That's that. No, but we are very happy that you're here from the Southeast Europe Media Organization, and I think we know you as a very active defender of the rights of the media. Media reporting from crisis is always difficult, and therefore it would be interesting to hear your opinion about that. So that's basically what we want to do tonight. Again, I'm very happy that you are here and that we can have that kind of interesting discussion and maybe ask Gudrun Gusel to start with a description of the humanitarian situation and what we have to do. Please.
Good evening also from my side. Caritas has been active in the humanitarian response since the beginning of the conflict in early 2014 when we were delivering medical assistance to victims at the Maidan. As you all know, this conflict is now already in the fourth year and it's a so-called protracted crisis, an invisible conflict. 1 week ago, during the 34th regular session of the United Nations Human Rights Council in Geneva, Caritas Internationalis delivered a statement concerning the worrying situation in Ukraine. This statement, prepared by our colleagues from Caritas Ukraine, warns about the international community's low attention for the crisis. Despite the grave human rights violations that occur on a daily basis. For nearly 3 years, the protected conflict in eastern Ukraine has triggered acute humanitarian needs and resulted in violation of fundamental human rights. Despite a sharp decrease in international attention, the war and conflict continues, and escalations unseen since the start of the conflict have been recorded in 2017. In Ukraine, we are faced with a forgotten war and an invisible humanitarian crisis. This crisis has impoverished millions of Ukrainians and deprived them of their basic needs and fundamental rights. The most vulnerable, the elderly, disabled and children, daily face the harsh realities of this war. The international community must help to end this war and refocus on this unseen humanitarian crisis, which is the only prospect for providing hope to those affected by the war in Ukraine. The war has claimed over 10,000 lives and has injured 2,300 people. 2,000 of those killed were civilians, most of whom died as a result of indiscriminate shelling in civilian areas. Beginning in late January 2017, fighting rapidly escalated around Avdiivka, a frontline community north of Donetsk city. Civilians, primarily children, were evacuated, and hundreds of civilian buildings were damaged or destroyed. Similar escalations have occurred this year in several locations along the contact line between warring parties. According to the OSCE, the use of heavy weaponry and the number of ceasefire violations has increased in 2017, which threatens to further jeopardize the precarious humanitarian situation. As a result of the war, over 1.7 million people have been registered as IDPs by the government of Ukraine, while another 1.1 million people are estimated to have fled to neighboring countries. 3.8 million people are in need of humanitarian assistance. Populations that have remained on both sides of the contact line, in addition to internally displaced persons in Ukraine, are unable to meet their basic needs for survival. Those still living in proximity to the contact line do not have the physical capacities or financial means to relocate. The elderly, disabled, and economically disadvantaged families comprise the majority of those remaining in frontline communities. Psychosocial needs are acute for those in proximity to the fighting, especially among children. Damage to civilian infrastructure, such as houses, schools, and hospitals, as well as severe restrictions on movement due to the conflict, has resulted in a lack of access of education, food and water, medicine and healthcare, and adequate shelter with heating. Caritas and other humanitarian actors are responding to the humanitarian needs among the conflict affected. However, access to non-governmental controlled areas is restricted, while access to communities in proximity to the contact line is periodically impeded due to ongoing fighting. We call on the international community to use its influence to ensure that all humanitarian actors can access non-governmental controlled areas where 2.3 million people, including 700,000 children, need life-saving assistance. Secondly, we are calling the parties to respect the fundamental human rights of civilians, as articulated in the Geneva Conventions, in the affected territories. International attention on the crisis in Ukraine may have diminished, but the humanitarian needs and violations of fundamental human rights are higher than ever. Urgent action is needed to protect the vulnerable and to allow the delivery of humanitarian assistance to those in need. This was the statement delivered last week to the UN. There have been a lot of attempts done. There were a lot of negotiations in Minsk. Ceasefires were agreed, but were violated again. And I think there's a great need, also from the side of Austria, using this OSCE presidency to call upon all the actors involved to stop this conflict.
Thank you very much. You have just been recently in Kiev. What's your impression? Is it a situation of hope? Is it a situation of despair, of having to realize that there will be a long-lasting conflict without improvements?
Yeah, if you... I would say it's individually very different. If you go, for example, to the contact line and visit homes of people, you see a lot of despair because people are facing daily shelling already for 3 or 4 years, and a lot of people had to relocate. But on the other hand, if you talk to children, to young people, they see a lot of hope and they really want to build up another country and another future. And I also see that the civil society has, so to say, increased its response. There is a lot of humanitarian assistance given by Ukrainians themselves, and there is still a big hope that at least the young generation will be able to change things. But on the other hand, also the fight against corruption in Ukraine has not been very successful. And if you think about the impoverishment of the population, if you think about the devaluation of the Ukrainian hryvnia in the last 3 years, and that a minimum pension is still not more worth than 50 euro a month, and for all those people who have no access to social benefits or other financial means, this is really very distressful. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Now, Roman Koval, perhaps you can describe how you see the situation, but maybe you also can say, because you are director of the Institute for Peace and Common Ground, what kind of common ground you are fighting for or have already. Maybe you can a bit describe also what your institute is doing and wants to achieve. Please.
Thank you, Hannes. Guten Abend. That's all I know in German. And thank you for coming today here. And it's an honor to be speaking with you today. Tonight about Ukraine and about the conflict. I represent the organization that has been doing conflict resolution work since 2001. In Ukraine, and our first dialogue project was in Crimea, between the Crimean Tatars and the local population, because the Crimean Tatars were coming back from the place where they have been deported, from Uzbekistan, and we faced already a lot of conflicts, which we felt as an organization that we need to respond. At that time, we already started talking about the divided society in Ukraine. So I really thankful to Ghana, to GUDRUN, for the introduction that you've made with your statement. If we talk about the conflict in Ukraine, of course, there are many perspectives, and I will not pretend that I will present the view which will explain it all, because there are many different ways from which you can look at the situation, and none of us will be really close to reality until we get enlightened and would be able to really see it as it is. if we talk about Russia, of course it's there, and of course if we talk about war, we can't really ignore their influence and their contribution, I would say, to the situation we have in Ukraine. However, it will be much more difficult for them to create a turmoil in Ukraine if there will be no this divided society in Ukraine beforehand. And the Maidan events and the revolution of dignity, as we call it now, really highlighted the differences which already existed in the society by that time. The thing that Ukraine got independent from the Soviet Union in 1991 may seem to many people as the great liberation from empire, but actually in terms of the identity that had many people in Ukraine, not so many things really have changed. It took about the new generation to grow up with a sense of being free and independent, with more opportunities to see the outside world, to travel abroad, to learn that they are Ukrainians, that learn a different version of the history that Ukraine had, to realize that they don't really want to be no longer the citizens of the state which is there to rule them. Rather, they want to be citizens of the open society in which freedom is one of the values, and they really want to have the opportunities to grow and develop, and being together as like joint people of one community, which has been later called as pro-European movement. So at the moment, we basically have two different populations in Ukraine. I would say one simplifiedly called pro-Ukrainian, others pro-Russian, which actually is more than this. It's half of the people who really want to get this liberation from the state which is controlling the citizens and be parts of the state which is there to serve the people who are the real part of this state and who are there to decide for themselves rather than to be ruled and controlled. And there is a big part of the population which still keeps this nostalgia about the Soviet period of time when you don't need to worry about the future, you don't need to take responsibility, you don't really need to worry about making decisions about your life because you've been taken care of. And we can understand these people as well because, you know, quite many of our parents really believe that that was the world in which every normal person has the right to be there. And the whole idea of human rights is understood by them as the state being responsible for their future, for their pension, for their salary, for employment at the end, and many other things. So the problem is that these two different worldviews that exist at the same time in the country, they don't really accept each other's presence as it normally possible in the country which has the longer history of democracy and has the longer history of bringing differences together and finding common ground and really understanding the importance of the consensus for the sake of peace. Therefore, we don't believe that dialogue is only needed at the eastern border of Ukraine, in the eastern part of Ukraine. We do believe that dialogue is really very needed all over Ukraine. We need tremendously dialogue in our politics, we need dialogue in our communities, and if you look at the problems that do exist in Ukraine, they're pretty much the same in the western part of Ukraine, in the central Ukraine, in the eastern part of Ukraine. Of course, eastern part of Ukraine is different. 4 weeks ago, I've been visiting communities along the contact line, and you will be surprised that basically among the needs that we were trying to identify within those communities, the shelling and the war which was going on in a very close proximity to their houses, they were not that much worried about this. They were worried about the fact that they cannot participate in the decision making, that they cannot really have the jobs, they are very poor. They're more worried about the economic situation, they're more worried about the police not doing their job, and they're more worried about corruption rather than the fight which is going on right there. Which was a bit surprising, and even though, well, we can't even imagine how hard the life is that these people are living, it's again about the fact that Ukraine is deeply divided within each community. And our organization is really trying to offer more opportunities for people to have dialogue rather than to have the local authorities get up there and explain everybody what's the right way of thinking and what is the decision that they've just made about the future of their lives, about the street lighting, and where it's more important to spend the budget that they have in this village. So... since the beginning of this conflict in Ukraine, I'm looking at Evgenia, she's writing so much, I'm looking forward to hear how she will comment on everything I said. Yeah. So the first initiative, dialogue initiative that we had was taking place in 12 communities across the border of Ukraine, basically to prevent the same thing that happened in Donetsk and Luhansk region. We were really aiming to take the violence away from the streets and get people talk about it. And get people sitting together trying to find ways how to resolve those issues that divides them. We had three different varieties of topics that people were discussing in the dialogue sessions, which we helped to organize by training local leaders from non-governmental organizations. Of course, the big part of that was ideological conflicts, or worldview conflicts, which we call that, which arise once people get the statue of Lenin falling down, or basically coming out into streets protesting against the renaming of streets from the communist leaders into something different, while people get used to what they already have, and many other things which were basically called Maidan, anti-Maidan. In Odessa it was a big discussion about the consequences of the May 2nd events, and why it happened and who is responsible and all that type of things. So the second set of topics was mostly social, economical, which really grew up tremendously after the Maidan events, because people saw that violence is one of the ways to resolve the differences. Like in Sumy, for example, people started beating the drivers and burning the taxi buses because they didn't like the price which was set up for the local public transportation. And the third one was about IDPs, of course. The need for their integration, both economical integration, was also followed by the psychological difficulties that these people were going through, because quite in many places they were not accepted by the host communities, being seen as those who are running away from the region which they've created as a problem region for the country. So the typical blame was, you were supposed to be there, either not allowing this whole thing to happen or being there in the front line protecting your own homeland, rather than having our young boys from the Western Ukraine going to the front line and fighting. So it wasn't easy, basically, to create those dialogues. Although in Zaporizhia, in Chernigiv, in Sumy, in Poltava, in Kherson, Odessa, and many other places, it was possible to create the dialogue platforms, which continue to work even till now. The topics are changing. Of course, in the second initiative, it was more about the relationship between community and the local authorities, maybe because we were just facing the elections of the local authorities, and it was also very important to help people to get the issues they have on their table resolved through the conversations and creating the working groups rather than through burning tires and putting the existing politicians into the garbage can. Now we are organizing dialogues about the reintegration of ex-combatants, the people who came back from the front line and facing tremendous difficulties both in their own psychological integration and acceptance of the local population of their difficult situation that they're facing. Of course, we can't really hope that adults will be the only one who will change this world, so our organization is working with kids. We created the School Center for Common Ground model, which trains students as mediators, and the local psychologist is their adult coordinator, who resolve the conflicts of their own peers at schools. And quite recently we've did the pilot in Mariupol with 22 schools, and the study have shown that the level of conflict decreases by 40% at school once it's done. So the reason I've been on the contact line was about creating the early warning system, in which we select a community reference group which monitors the situation, basically creates altogether the database of the events that take place at different communities, which helps both the international organizations and the donor community monitor the situation. And we use this information to generate the dialogue within community about the ways to address some of those issues and how to basically find consensus about which will take the most importance, where the resources may come from, and part of our work is also to provide a little bit of these resources and bring them in touch with the donor organizations and who will be responsible basically for implementing the actions that the citizens of the communities would agree together. I think I've been talking too much already, so...
Thank you very much. No, it was very interesting. It's an enormous work you do. How many people do you have? 500,000, 2,000 to do that job?
In our organization at the moment, we have 7 people, but we have experts who are teaching others. We have 17 organizations as part of our network across Ukraine. So we've trained them as dialogue facilitators and organizers, and we work in close contact with them once we talk about the dialogue in communities. Plus, we have about maybe 30 other people whom we trained as the School Center for Common Ground teachers and trainers.
Thank you very much. Now, Evgenia, Roman just said, well, if there wouldn't be this conflictuous situation in Ukraine and the division, the Russians couldn't have intervened in that way. If I remember well, and if I may repeat that, what you said just in the preparation, you said if there wouldn't be Russia, there wouldn't be war. So it's a very difficult situation. You have the conflict inside Ukraine and you have the outside intervention. So what are the sides in the conflict? Are there different sides? Are there? Is it an external conflict? Is it an internal conflict? Is it both? Maybe you can a bit define, and then of course would be interesting what can art and artists do to not only to live with the conflict, but perhaps to live in a better way and perhaps to have steps in order to overcome that conflict. Besides, of course, all the comments you were writing and Roman was curious about to know, but please.
Thank you for invitation. When I read the title of the discussion, I was afraid that it will be again another one discussion about how a dialogue can stop the war in Ukraine, as if we can, through developing new way of speaking with other people, stop the war that is killing people every day in Ukraine. Practically every day we read in the news that some people are dying. And very often we don't know about people who are dying just in the area of the war, because mostly it is always news are all mostly speaking about soldiers which are dying on the border between occupied and not occupied territory of Ukraine. And yes, I was afraid, and I think it is really important to clarify that Ukraine yes, has different groups and has lots of political discussions inside of Ukraine. And because of different and lots of economical crises, we have a large group of unsatisfied communities that are angry with their lives. But still, Ukraine would never have a situation of ongoing killing people and war zone without Russia intervening in Ukraine, and practically Russian military forces occupying a part of Ukraine. It is the first thing that we should understand. And then, if you are speaking about the dialogue, it is always for me the question, what is this dialogue about and what are the parts of this dialogue? Is it a dialogue between Ukrainians who cannot understand each other in the current situation, or it is a dialogue between Russian and Ukraine, or is it a dialogue between Ukrainians and people who are now ruling this occupied territories and are practically not somebody who can take a political decisions, but Russia is taking the political decisions for them. What is this dialogue about? And I think that in international context of reading the situation, of understanding the Ukrainian war, the problem is that very often we are speaking about the dialogue, not really clarifying which dialogue we are now really meaning. And yes, it is the first thing. And secondly, about two Ukrainians. You were speaking about two Ukrainians and about pro-Soviet and new modern Ukraine. And this idea, this interpretation of Ukrainian society was started in the 90s, and also some of Ukrainian intellectuals, like Mykola Rybchuk, developed the idea that there are two countries. These people, these intellectuals, were traveling to eastern Ukraine, to the industrial areas of Ukraine, where people mostly were speaking Ukrainian dialect close to Russian or Russian language. At the same time, they were traveling to western Ukraine, where big industry was much less represented, and they just decided that these two different economies may mean different life approaches for people. And they wrote some books, but now these people who wrote these books, even Mykola Rybchuk, are publicly saying that maybe it was a mistake, maybe we misunderstood something at that moment when we first from Western Ukraine, because lots of them, most of them are have a Western Ukrainian origin. Maybe we misunderstood something when we went in the Eastern Ukraine to study this country. Maybe we just were too busy with this post-Soviet or Soviet period, how we can overcome it. So I think there are not two Ukraines, but there are if you will use these terms, there are 100 Ukrainians. I mean, there are there is Ukraine of young people, which are very different in different regions of Ukraine. There is a Ukraine of people who are receiving a rent from the state, and they cannot work anymore. And if their rent is miserable and nothing, they remember the Soviet times where rent was much much bigger, and where they were feeling themselves much more as people, as persons, than now, when they are practically destroyed by these small amounts of money that they are getting every month. But it doesn't mean that they are pro-Soviet. It doesn't mean that they are like old way of thinking and stopping Ukraine being modern. No, it is completely the opposite. These people were people who were on Maidan, and these people were on Maidan speaking about the honor that should be that Ukrainian people should get back. Honor, it doesn't mean also, it means also to be paid well enough, not to be forced to take bribes on the level of all Ukrainian schools or of Ukrainian hospitals. If Ukrainian hospitals are saying, yes, we are a bit, people working there, I mean, are saying, yes, we are a bit nostalgic about Soviet era, it means that in Soviet era, they were paid well enough not to be bribed by every patient. And in the Soviet era, they maybe were getting enough medical support to give it for free to the patients. So are these people just pro-Soviet or old thinking, or these people maybe don't have another reference points, and they are referring to the time where the life was different, but not because and I don't think they are pro-Soviet. And to clarify my idea, I will tell you, not for a long time, about project I was working on since 2014. The title of the project is The Victories of the Defeated. And the idea of it is, if you can... Yes, it's connected to the Walter Benjamin idea that mostly we are reading the history written by the victorious, and I'm asking the question if we can read, if it is possible to hear or to read the history written by the defeated. The purpose of this project was to speak about the communities that are existing in the region of war, in the situation of war. But they are not playing they are not following, they refuse to follow the rules of the war situation. They were proceeding to live peaceful lives in the situation of occupation or of the war. During the Donbas war, some cities of Donbas were occupied and then made again Ukrainian by Ukrainian army. And they worked in the cities which for some times were occupied by DNR or LNR people. And you know that the ideology of, yes, what is again complicated, the ideology of this official ideology of this occupation forces, DNR and LNR Republic, occupied practically ground and new free republics of Ukraine, is to come back to Soviet era. We will come back to Soviet era, they are saying. So when they were occupying Ukrainian cities, they were promising people that we will bring you again to these golden times. And I worked there in mines, photographing mostly miners in mines in the situation of war that is coming near, going on nearby. And you know that if some mine will be under attack, lots of people can die at one moment. It is very easy because large groups of people are working deep underground. So I was photographing underground and in the area, in the industrial area, and creating photographs together with people working there. We were developing images. It is not only my project, but really a common project to develop with people from that area of Ukraine. And what I discovered, people which were working in those mines during the occupation period, when these cities were occupied, one of the goals of the new DNR, LNR administration was to destabilize mines and to make from these people who were working there soldiers. Ukraine at the same time was interpreting or seeing these people as enemies, as some pro-Soviet, anti-modern Ukrainians. And these people were from one side, they were forced to take part in the war by the new occupation government, and they were said, we will pay you, we will pay you, you will be paid in dollars for participating in war. Just say yes, take a gun and leave the mine. On the other time, Kyiv was sending very bad signals. Kyiv was saying, oh, these people in the occupied cities, maybe they are enemies, maybe they don't like Ukraine, they don't like modern Ukraine, they like Soviet Union, they don't understand that we want to be a Europe, we want to create an open society. That people don't want to create an open society. They want to be always protected by the state. They want to be paid every month. Like. And these people were just working in state mines. So it's normal for them to wait that they will be paid every month for their work. Incredibly hard work. And they are, in any case, they were not paid incredibly well, even officially. So, what in this crazy situation, what happened? Nobody decided to go to the war. I mean, the mines in Lysychansk. Like, from the mine where 2,000 or 3,000 people were working, two went in DNR army or LNR army. Like, from 2,002 persons. And I wondered how it is possible if Kyiv is saying you are enemies and another people are coming saying you are our friends, you are great, we will create new great state which will be Soviet again, take part and we will go to Kyiv and we will change the world and so on. Why these people stayed in mine, making this work almost for free, being not paid, being constantly seen as some collaborators by Kyiv government. Why? And the goal of my project was to tell the story why they did it. Practically, they decided that they don't want to understand the whole politics. They don't want to think whether it is a war between Russia and Ukraine, or the war between new republics and Ukraine, or it is war between maybe America and Russia taking part in Ukraine, or another crazy war between Martians and Earth people. They decided they will not understand what is going on, but they will see what their community needs today, and what their community needed today, yesterday, and today it needed to have work, to have possibility, like you said, to live their lives. And therefore, they should do everything to protect the mine because it was only one stable work source in this place. And they thought, whatever will happen, we will not go in the war and we will close our doors and not allow people from republics, politicians, guru agents, they didn't know who they were. We will not allow them to come inside of our industrial area saying that it is a special object. So they closed the doors. The corrupt director of the mine, he is corrupt, and I think he was very corrupt, but he was arrested by the government of LNR, put into a cellar, and forced to say to his employees publicly, stop working, take part in the war, we will win this war, and the life will be better. And also he was very corrupt and crazy, maybe. I saw him once, and he is not a pleasant person, but still, he said no. He said, I will not do it, I will not say, because even these corrupt people, maybe they are very bad, but they are not demons, they are not poor evil. He was understanding that most of these workers will just die in this war. And he was not a mass murderer. He decided that, okay, maybe I will sit in hell after this because I stole an incredible amount of money and betrayed lots of people. But at least I will not kill all my workers or most of my workers. So he said that he will not say it. And after 4 days sitting in the cellars, he was just released, yes. And he proceeded to be a director of the mine, and recently there was a corruption scandal and he lost his job. But my project was about this. I was photographing practically people working in the mine, and I was speaking with people from lots of cities. I went through the
I went through the Lugansk Gebiet, and also I worked in Debaltseve, the city that now is practically, it belongs not to Ukraine anymore. I worked in the cities in the time where it was very dangerous to be there in 14, where cities were constantly attacked and people were in complete different state of mind as I could. As we can even imagine, living in the city which is constantly attacked it's incredible. Yes, people were trying to protect their way of life, but I think they were in deep shock that the war is going on. And I think that even so, today, lots of Ukrainians really used to the war situation. I mean, lots of Ukrainians which are living in the war zone, if cities will be attacked again as they were in 2014, they will be shocked again. And it is a very big mistake of Ukraine that we are not saving these people intentionally, that we are not working all together on making it possible for people in occupied and close to war territories to leave these territories. Ukraine is doing nothing. And in this situation, when Ukraine is doing not enough, it's very hard to speak about the dialogue. If a person has nothing to eat, I mean, it's not like that luckily in Ukraine, but if the person is not able to be sure about the basic needs, it will really constantly fight for living and not think about dialogues. And maybe if this person has a 3 minute, it will hate somebody. So I think to solve the crisis, to start a dialogue, we should really understand that Russia is constantly creating the situation where people are dying, and we should be aware of it and speak directly about it so we can develop the political and economical arguments to stop Russia to support this war. And second level, we should force Ukraine to think more about social politics and not to say, oh, social politics is very Soviet and we are modern, therefore maybe we don't need to do it. No, we should really stop these lies, and then maybe conflict will just disappear and people will maybe fight with each other with words.
Thank you very much. It was very interesting. And it was perfect. There was no reason to switch into German, so or Ukrainian. So that, no, absolutely. Thank you. I have many questions, but maybe in the second round, we'll leave you a bit time. And let's go to Oliver Vujovic about the media. Of course, our information here in Austria or in Europe in general is very much depending on how media can report. So you have a lot of experience, of course, also from other crises. How do you see the media situation if such a crisis like in Ukraine is happening? Is it possible to have reliable media reports? And please.
Thanks. I think it was now clear, or it's clear, becomes clear to everyone that we hear how the problems are and how many problems we have in Ukraine, that for the journalists, of course, it's a very hard job. And I'm not speaking only for the domestic Ukrainian journalists, who have to work, who have to report from the crisis area. I speak also about international journalists who are covering this area. And it's like in every conflict, in every war. And a lot of things that are happening today in Ukraine happened in one part of Europe some 20 years ago, when you speak about the area of former Yugoslavia. And as a journalist who was covering that time for some media also here in Austria, that area, I'm saying, a lot of things is the same for journalists. It's very hard. We are speaking about, we speak about the conflict area. I'm not speaking now about reporters who are sitting in Kiev, but those who are reporting from the conflict area, from the occupied area. When we speak about that, it's hard to report. It's hard to report because we are speaking about a lot of propaganda from both sides. Very often we hear about Russia propaganda that is very, very strong, but sometimes we forget also that the other side is also using sometimes propaganda. As in every war, in every conflict, you have this propaganda war, and it's very important to understand it, that is part of the reality. It's part of the reality also, this patriotic journalism, and politicians who are on both sides speaking about this patriotic role of media, journalists, and so on. We have decisions, stupid decisions by politicians, like some days ago, we know very well this crazy, stupid decision by Putin to forbid the work, more or less, of NGOs in Russia. We have now a decision from Poroshenko some days ago where he decided that journalists should put in some way public, the money, the income, and so on, declare the income. But it's also a stupid decision. So I'm saying both politicians, the domestic politician in that way, and the from the Russian, the foreign politicians, are making stupid decisions that are not helping dialogue, they're not helping normalization of the situation. And as I said, for journalists, it becomes very hard to work under these conditions. The fact is, after all our evidence that we have in our office, 5 journalists were killed and 2 additional media workers were killed in this area of East Ukraine in the past, since 2013, it means last 14, that means the last 3 years. We have many injured journalists. There's no free movement. It means we know so many cases where journalists had to leave this occupied Russian controlled territory because the local politicians, or under influence from Moscow, they decided that some journalists are not welcome in that area. On the other side, we had decisions also from the officials in Kiev where they forbid journalists, most of them came from Russia, but we have to accept these are journalists also if they maybe come from an enemy country, but they are doing the job, and maybe they are part also of the Putin propaganda, but still, to forbid them to not to report is a bad decision. It's not a democratic decision, and that is what I'm saying. We need more dialogue, more open-minded people on both sides, and I think, I believe in dialogue, and I will say, having the experience from every war, after every war you have peace, once will be peace, one will be start of normalization. If it's in 1 year or maybe 10 years, we don't know in this moment, but we have one moment. After every conflict, after every war, we have some peace. And I think the big problem is, when I speak also with journalists, they're saying the international community was not doing enough in solving and helping the solving of the problem. There are not enough used instruments that could be used for solving the problem in East and the Crimea area. And I think that this is the thing, if you would like to have a dialogue, we need also more, I would say, active work from Western countries, also from here, from Austria. I think Austria, as a neutral, non-NATO state and so on, can play a more important role than it's playing today. I'm always saying Austria is not using enough the power it can have. Maybe the power that Austria had in the 70s, with Palestine, Israel, and some other cases, I think this power we're missing today in Austria. And I'm saying always, Austria must more use the power that it can have. And I think also in solving the problems, in this case, Austria can play a bigger and more important role. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Maybe before we go to the general discussion, a second round. Maybe, Gudrun, if I ask you, we heard about the difficulties of journalists. How is about Caritas and similar organizations? Are they able to deliver what they want to do or what the citizens want from them? Or what kind of obstacles and impediments do you have for your work on both sides or on one of the sides?
So Caritas had been active in the non-governmental controlled areas until even early 2015. But then it was no more possible, but it was also due to a ban from the Ukrainian side and the non-governmental controlled de facto authorities. So for us it would be very important. We still have our old structure in the offices in Donetsk, for example, and are still working there in a very limited way, but it would be very important for us to have access to the non-governmental controlled areas, what is concerned the work in the buffer zone. So we are trying to reach out to people who are really left behind, These are mostly elderly, chronically ill and disabled people. We are giving home-based care, we are training community care workers because a lot of humanitarian aid is delivered to safe points, but those people are not in a position to go to these points and collect the aid themselves. So social workers are also assisting the people to get their pensions or other benefits they need. We are also working in schools, in 16 schools along the contact line, working with children, giving psychosocial assistance. But it's also very important. In summer we had several hundred children from the buffer zone on vacation and also on, so to say, on treatment in Western Ukraine. And when I visited 3 weeks ago some schools in Stanitsa Luganska, and they were telling me what a great experience this was for them, especially particularly to see that they're peaceful territories in their own countries and how beautiful Western Ukraine is. Yeah, and so for me, what I also see, it's very important that this peace building and this dialogue is going on, that also children from non-government controlled areas will get into contact with Ukrainian children and so on. Yeah, because there are pictures created. If you have been living for 3 or 4 years in a city that that every night the fighting is going on and you're not able to go out in the afternoon, in the evening, you cannot lead a normal youth life. If we're asking the children, for example, what are your wishes, not one of them had a material wish. Yeah, so all of them, and even they didn't wish for only peace for Ukraine. They wished that there would be no more homeless people in the world. And so it was really touching that they were also thinking not only about what is going on in their communities. And so they are also, the youth are organizing flash mobs for peace, although they are stuck in these villages, in these cities. And I think it's very important also to have, as Roman was telling, we are also working in other parts of Ukraine, for example in Odessa, and we experienced the same, what you said, that a lot of people face the problems of integration, and it's very important to have these peace-building projects also in other parts of the country. And there are also a lot of families where mostly the husbands were in the war in the east, and they come back and they are maybe no more able to work. They've lost feet and arms and are very traumatized, and it's very hard also to accommodate back into the families. So there's a lot of trauma all over Ukraine, which we can observe in our work. So it's not only in the eastern parts. So if we are telling, if UNICEF is telling now that 1 million children are directly affected in the buffer zone and in the occupied territories, I think it's a whole generation of children that is more or less suffering now in Ukraine. And what I see, it's very important both from the Ukrainian side and from the non-governmental controlled areas to open the borders and to make this movement and exchange of people possible. When you are in Stanitsa Luganska, this is the only crossing point in the whole Lugansk Oblast, is this wooden bridge where you have to walk down, then you have to walk several meters flat, and then you have to walk steeply up. And it's 1.5 kilometers of walk before you reach again a street. And this is the lifeline for a lot of people. We saw people that were transporting refrigerators and I don't know what from one territory to the other. And for some people it's the only provision line. And if these checkpoints are constantly cut and even the delivery of humanitarian aid would be hampered, also from Ukrainian side, this would have severe effects of the people on the other side. We do not know how is life in the villages of the in the other side of the buffer zone. There might be a lot of elderly people, of chronically ill people dying without nobody knowing.
Thank you very much for this description of the tragic situation. Roman, one of the intention of the Maidan people has been to fight against corruption, to stop the corruption, which has been very, very strong in the former regime. Now, there was recently, some months ago already, some legislation about transparency, of opening up the accounts that everybody has to show. Maybe it was also in connection then with the journalists. Some people say that was a big step forward. Other people say, well, we know now who from the politicians or the civil servants know what, own what, but then what happens? Nothing happens. So how, as corruption is very often more or less identified or connected with Ukraine, how is the fight against corruption? How do you see the status? Is there progress, much progress, not too much progress?
Now I see a sympathy in your eyes. Well, before I answer,
wants to know as well.
Before I answer your question, I want to explain myself, of course. And this is what happens when you have 7 minutes to tell the conflict. I was trying to find a simplified analogy to basically explain what I believe the conflict is about. First of all, and of course I understand, like in every conflict, we try to find in our head the analogies and we put them together. Like every attorney, when we talk to them about mediation, they say, of course we know, we do this. And being the mediator between two conflicting parties not always mean that you are a mediator in the mediation process. So, first to make clear, we didn't use Mykola Rybchuk's theory as the basis for our work.
And
we were not talking about two Ukraines. We were talking about different layers which we have in our society. And the only reason I was using the analogies of Soviet time and the open society is because I didn't really overwhelm the audience with social psychology, because otherwise I could have been talking about the archaic society, which is based on the people's instinct of survival and the other instincts that we all have. And it's all hierarchical always, with the alpha male on top, and, you know, control which is really spread down through different layers of responsibility. And the different type of society, which I call the open society, which is basically the collaboration of people, in which dialogue is the usual way of communication, because we respect each other and we not really look for hierarchy. Now once I said this, I believe that basically, why are we doing dialogue? Because for us, dialogue is a tool. It's also an education tool, because it really aims for understanding. And if you open the class, it's quite unlikely that you will have people come to your classroom and basically talk about the values of open society. But once you have people discussing their community problems, then it's more likely that one side, with a good facilitation, would be able to understand the needs of the other side and understand, most importantly, why it's important for them. And they will see the same nature of a human being in the opposite side. So we are, at the end, we're all similar. We are not very much different. And the fact that these ones who felt themselves now more kind of free and more independent from the state, they will not really be so afraid that they will be dragged back by this crowd into something they don't really like. And quite unusual for many of them will be to discover that actually there are lots of similarities in the way we see the importance of this life, the needs, and each other at the end. And with these similarities, we can find ways to live together. So with coming to your question about corruption, I think this is indeed two different perspectives, whether it was a good thing to do or it was a bad thing to do. still, I think, in the society which has a life conflict in it, it's pretty obvious that whatever happens in the society, it will be a trigger for two different opinions and two different positions. And of course, a lot of people who are not satisfied with what's going on, they will find that this is just an illustration that we are taken around by these corrupt politicians and nothing is changing because they are making lots of money and there is nothing we can do about this. And this is also an illustration that, well, of course, it's still the same archaic society in which the one on the top gets the most and everybody else in the down layer, they get nothing at the end. If we would really be able to talk about this and understand and discuss and find ways of how we can actually use what have been done and the disclosure of all these things, then there will be many positive ways of looking at what happened. Because now at least the whole idea of making your own income public, and if you're a politician and you're supposed to really be open and responsible most of all, then you should be doing this. And then now we have a starting point in which we can compare what these guys declared now with what have been would have been done next year, etc., etc. So I think, like many other things, and the blockade, which we haven't been talking yet, but I was thinking about it when we were talking about the importance of really keeping the ties between non-government controlled territory and the government controlled territory, because we as an organization, we are thinking about the future reintegration and the restoration and transitional justice that needs to happen at this time. So we totally support any relationship that do exist between Ukrainians on this side and on that side. And it's really a shame that the state level cannot afford to acknowledge the importance of this, because they are really trapped in the words of the radicals, and they're afraid of being open in their words mm-hmm. about all the things that is taking place there and why it's important.
Thank you very much. Of course, it's very useful, I think, if you react also to your statements of your partners here. But, Evgenia, you spoke about the mines and your project, and I think that was very, very interesting and encouraging in a way. Now, we heard about the decision changing from one day to another, but the final decision, I think, was from the government to support the blockade or to cut, if that's wrong, please correct us, to cut the links between the mines and the enterprises in the occupied area and the rest. It was first done by some rebels, then it was rejected by the government, finally by the security institutes, it was said. Is that useful to have that, or what is your opinion about that? Because does it change the situation in the mines, which you were describing? And maybe you can also add on the Eurovision song ban of the Russian singer. We don't want to concentrate on this issue, but as it was also mentioned in European media, also in Austria, maybe a comment on that as well.
It's hard to combine these two areas of reality, Eurovision and mines. It's not easy. I can start...
Not combining, but separate answers.
When I was visiting mine in 2015, again mine in Lysychansk, near the city of Lysychansk, I saw a mountain of coal that this mine produced that was just being there, not taken away. It was a huge amount, and it was like I asked them, what is it? And miner said to me, for a year, it is a year of work of ours, and nobody is really taking care of it, and nobody is taking it from us, and we are also not getting paid because we are not producing enough oil. Why these things were happening? You think because of war maybe, but this mine was on Ukrainian territory. Maybe transport was not working. No, trains were coming and connecting the city of Lysychansk with Ukraine in the main territory. with Kiev. Why it was possible? And only one answer I could get, speaking with different human rights activists, journalists, and insiders of Ukrainian politics, that they were unclear, dark games going on about who will possess these mines after the conflict or during the conflict, how this mine maybe would be privatized or should it be closed at the moment of the conflict in 2015. And to do it, they just are showing this mine as unproductive and not taking the coal away from it. I mean, isn't it a war? But who is fighting with whom? It is, again, the corruption in form of unhuman activities of Ukrainian state that then and then the whole city can suffer because of it. And blockade that is going on now, it's just of a proceeding of this politics. Ukrainian Ukrainian government is using right wing or is afraid of right wing. We never know. It is very hard to know. But both, yeah. But if you are saying both, you are like saying, you know, both is possible. Like you said, Putin has his problems. Poroshenko has his problems. They are then equally bad. They are both bad, but not equally bad. I mean, it's important to understand, and we can never say both, because when we are saying both and not describing it deeply, then it is like not, it is not important which side is really working in politics and social map of Ukraine. And if Ukrainian government is just using right-wing groups to say why they are initiating a blockade, to make this conflict deeper, to make the connections between people even more traumatic, then it is one story. If the government is so weak that Ukrainian small right-wing groups are able to dictate what should happen on the huge national level, it is another story. And it is very sad again, but we should then have a different approach to it. But it's very hard to develop two approaches at the same time with two completely different concepts of what is going on in the country. If both things are happening, we should at least know which percentage in which case is influence the situation. I mean, if you don't know it, if you cannot explain it for us, then we just are scientists who are watching the situation, watching only the surface of the situation and documenting it in different ways, or documentary artists. I believe that your goal of your organization as partly of the projects I'm trying to develop is really not only to start speak about some of the things, but to raise awareness of some problems or maybe change something. So I think what you have said about the people abandoned in the uncontrolled area, it's clear enough. I shouldn't add anything. If people are really abandoned there, and we all know about it, and the blockade is taking place, it means that the whole society agrees to dehumanization and the politics of dehumanization. And I don't believe that Ukrainian society is really supporting this kind of politics. I think that Ukrainian society is very poor, very stressed, and under the constant situation of crisis and fighting for surviving, so we don't have enough voice, people who are against it, and I think majority is against it, are not able to just get a political voice to speak about it. And I think that such politics is influencing the whole society. On the macro level, blockade is described as a decision to make Russia responsible for uncontrolled territories. If Ukrainian is blockading these territories, it means Ukraine has not a control. You know it. You cannot really do anything on these territories. I, as an artist, I tried a lot to go there. I contacted fixers that were working with BBC and with international journalists, and they said, okay, you are registered in Kyiv in your Ukrainian passport. I said, yes. We can say that you will, we can promise you that you will not be in jail like 30%. If you are agree to go in the frame of this, if you agree, then we can meet you at the border and you can work with us. So even for me, who is very critical sometimes about Ukrainian government politics, it's impossible to work on this territory. So Ukraine is not controlling them. And then Ukraine is saying on the macro political level, okay, these territories, we can't do anything there. We can't protect people there. We can't even go there. So we will close the border, and Russia, which started this conflict, which can go there, and Russian people constantly are going to these territories and making films on YouTube about them participating in fights, attacking Ukraine, and so on, and about Russian humanitarian help. We see lots of movies. So if Russia can constantly go there and have a best contact with this area, then Russia should have a responsibility for this territory. It is practically macro level what Ukrainian is saying. But on this macro level, we don't see the concrete lives of people that are just destroyed by this politics. And this is a problem of Ukraine. On some of the levels, on the level of fight with aggression, Putin's aggression, it can even sound logical that this territory should be boycotted, should be cut out. But if we will, we cannot allow ourselves to be only on this level of understanding the situation. We should go on the people's level. On that level, it is a complete crazy irrational politic.
Okay, let's leave the Eurovision song aside. Maybe come back, Oliver. You spoke about the rights of the journalist, and we fully support that. What are the obligations of journalists? Do journalists have an obligation to promote dialogue, to have some aim in their reporting, or is it just that they have to report what is happening? Do you see more in it, or how do you see the situation?
Okay, it's also individual how a journalist sees his role. Of course, there's the basic role to report about facts, what is happening. But also facts you can see with one eye and the second eye, and one thing has happened, and two journalists will report different about some things. But there's also this other element that journalists should have also some other role for the society, for the good of society. What means also, in some way, there is a general obligation, or journalists should support elements like peace, what means also dialogue. So if a journalist with his report can do something positive, I will always support it. But you cannot say it's obligation of journalists, because every journalist should work independent, respect some professional standards, and these professional standards, but that is also, if you respect these professional standards, you're helping the dialogue. Because if you're doing reporting about problems, what is happening somewhere, using the facts, what is happening, and not making some propaganda, you will make the dialogue easier. But when you are doing as a journalist, you become a journalist, part of this propaganda. And what we have, speaking about Russian media, so many propaganda, but I'm saying also on the other side, there are cases. And then you're not helping the dialogue. And that's very bad, that journalists are becoming instruments, and this is very, that happened again in this conflict, that journalists are becoming very often instruments of some political or other interests. And so the only will say very often source of information that you can use sometimes in these conflict zones are international journalists. But then we have again the problem that the international journalists cannot move free from one part of Ukraine to this other part that is occupied. And speaking not about the detail that many journalists from Kiev cannot move free to the occupied zone and so on. So I would say journalists should help it out, but we cannot say it's a must for them.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that was very interesting, and thank you also for the very differentiated pictures you showed. It's not the black and white picture. And now I have some questions or some remarks. Please, not long statements, but it would be interesting. Yes, 1, 2, 3, 4.
I started first 4 days ago. At that time I was lying at bed, listening to the shelling from Lugansk Stanitsa. Because I was in Lugansk then, first time. And at the same day, I had a meeting with Rudnitsky. During this meeting, in which I spent about 1 hour, I achieved, after very hard work, nearly half a year, the first, for me, symbol to showing a possibility for Taiwan. I get a card from a prisoner of war of Ukraine. This card is sent to his letter. It's in progress. I hope tomorrow she will get this letter. To be a little bit short, I fully agree what you said, that I think Austria is not using this role, but would be possible for Austria. Because I only get this letter of Ukrainian prisoner, because I was talking all about history of especially social democratic history of Bruno Kreisler, for example, as he were working at peace process in between Israel and Palestine. And of course, I think there is now a short time that this window is open to start this dialogue. But I'm only a member of social society, and of course in Luhansk I only worked with this social society. And I'm very interested in your experiences with Luhansk Republic, because as I was observing that always the situation in Luhansk Republic is more difficult than in Donetsk, because it seems to me that in Donetsk government is more open. But I think it's very important. I have got a lot of experiences to prove, to get this evidence that people really, normally people, have a lot of difficulties that nobody can imagine. For example, one couple who is living in Lugansk because their house was destroyed in Lugansk Stanitsa, where she should live. She's going to Lugansk because her parents are living there. It's not a question of political or ideology reason. It's a normal question where to live, yes? Where are the bad possibilities for them?
Okay, thank you.
And for this reason, I think it's very important to put pressure on Austrian politicians to try to get this chance to occupy.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
My question is, perhaps some more macro than you even catched, you say macro better. So my question is, do you have the right partners for monologue or dialogue? That means, do you see the right partners just in Russia and Ukraine? And I would guess, the reaction of Russia was just a reaction of the European Union and America. So, from my point of view, you do not touch one of the partners, and the main partner who came to Maidan without intervening in the internal affairs, said, yeah, you should come, you should be associated, you should come to NATO, and the poor Ukrainians, you see, like honey, yeah, they came and said, yeah, we want to come. I can assure you, the first ambassador I spoke here from Ukraine said, we have to go to NATO. I said, why? We in Austria, we are not to NATO. Yeah, otherwise we cannot come to EU. Okay, that new for me, but if you think so, and always the same. The Ukrainians, a part of them, want to be like bees to honey and come immediately be associated. It was not serious to be associated or to become a EU member. Never. We never can take such a big, huge country within the EU without problems as we have at the moment. That would be a complete mess. So my point of view is, why do you just concentrate on Russia, who is a puppet, as well as you are the puppets, on a string, on a reaction, on what is bringing in from the EU side, from the Western side, who is more or less rolling toward Russia as NATO and by other forces you cannot see. Remember, you as a brother of Russia cannot imagine what it would mean for Russia, what it would mean for Russia if NATO comes and goes to this wonderful island they took now in their possession. Yeah?
Okay.
Thank you.
Please.
Being a journalist and having been to research with Ukraine in this last week, I wanted to ask you, from the outside, there is always this reference point of Minsk too. Of course, it is used always to say that the other side doesn't fulfill means true, and that's why it's not happening. It's a sort of a joker for promoting mutual accusations. What do people really think about this means to agreement? Do they believe that it is a common ground, and can it be theoretically fulfilled, or did people already give up hope that this is the way?
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. I'm Yuri. I'm with the Ukrainian Embassy in Vienna, and I'd like to thank you very much for inviting me here to be part of the audience. And I think it's a very useful platform that you have organized to exchange opinions and to spread more information about what is happening in Ukraine, because as GUDRUN Gusel rightly said, the international attention has been somewhat diminishing in the recent time. So it's a very good opportunity to raise this issue back again to our agenda. And also perhaps to try to disintegrate some myths that have appeared around the conflict. And here I'd like to go back to what Roman said about having a challenge to explain the nature of this conflict in just 7 minutes. And I would say perhaps it's not a matter of time, but it's a matter of substance, because you cannot approach this conflict with a classic pattern of conflict resolution and analysis. There is no ethnic part in it, there is no geographical logic in it, there is no religious logic in it. It's a hybrid conflict that is a new type of conflict and needs a new approach towards analysis and towards resolving the conflict. But perhaps to also add just a couple of arguments with regard to what was said by Roman about various opinions in the Ukrainian society. I don't think it were the differences of the opinions in the Ukrainian society that prompted Russia to grab and annex Crimea, to send its soldiers to Crimea. I don't think it were any differences in the Ukrainian society that provoked Russia to send its soldiers to Donetsk and Luhansk. And I don't think, to be honest, that we can count on classic CBM conflict building measures right now as being a feasible path towards a conflict resolution at the moment. I would perhaps focus a bit more on the dialogue and to tell you the story how the government, which came to power in February 2014, addressed this issue when the conflict was flaring up in Donetsk and Luhansk. So what the government did was to create a platform, what that was called a platform for the national dialogue. Rings a bell, the name explains itself. It involved the political players from the new government, it involved politicians and elected representatives from the eastern regions of Ukraine. There were three rounds, if I'm not mistaken, in Kharkiv, in Mykolaiv, and in Kyiv. There were heads of local councils from Donetsk and Luhansk participating in that endeavor. There were MPs from the eastern regions participating in that endeavor. And that was moderated by Wolfgang Ischinger, the chairperson of the Munich Security Conference. It was the platform that offered a chance for every grievance to be heard, for every argument to be discussed. And it was a successful one. It led to, it was a heated discussion, but it led to a common understanding what a future of Ukraine should look like. What happened then? We had Mr. Putin and we had Russia saying, no, your dialogue is wrong. You're talking to the wrong people. The elected representatives from Donetsk and Luhansk are not representing these regions anymore. And they gave us a list. And the list had people in it who were already taking arms and holding buildings in Donetsk and Luhansk. People who became later known from very sad news in the TV as being those who shoot and indiscriminately shell and who kill and who became warlords. It was said these people now represent these regions. So it was not the matter of absence of dialogue or absence of platform. And I would agree with what Yevgenia said. It's not a matter of just having another moderated, well-moderated, well-rehearsed dialogue that would bring the resolution of this conflict. You need to address the root cause, and the root cause is the position of Russia that is not fulfilling the Minsk agreement.
Okay, thank you.
I would have three questions to three people from the panel. The first question to Mrs. Gusel, you spoke about indiscriminate shelling. Do you have any reliable data on which side did some shelling to which side? I would be interested in that. Second question for Mr. VUJOVIĆ, you spoke about Putin being against NGOs. Now, according to my understanding, he's like against George Soros-backed NGOs, as they are some kind of regime, as they are viewed as some kind of regime-changing NGOs. So maybe you could also give a little bit more detail about which NGOs Putin is against. And my third question would be, go to Yevgenia Belorusets. Are you aware that there's an intercepted phone call freely available on YouTube between Victoria Nuland and Jeffrey Pyatt, the former ambassador, or maybe current ambassador to Ukraine, in which Victoria Nuland let loose her infamous fuck the EU statement, and where she also, or where the two US officials give quite revealing information about their plans for Ukraine, and there's lots of other data available for you, and basically that data leads me to review your statement that Russia started this conflict at least as incomplete. So,
thank you. The lady there, yes.
Thank you. I came tonight because I was lured by the fact that we are having or watching a dialogue on Ukraine, as I professionally also try to work and set up ways to create dialogue in Ukraine and to analyze dialogues that work and don't work. So I understood that from the podium that you not all agree the dialogue is useful. But for those who do, I would like to understand What would it look like, a dialogue? What would the result be? What would be successful dialogue in your mind?
Yeah. Thank you, dear.
Okay, if I'm next. Thank you very much for all the interesting contributions. I just wonder concerning the initial statement of Mrs. Belorusets. Sorry, I have to read it. I have difficulty pronouncing it. And he said, rightly, I think, in contrast to the previous speaker, that all this conflict is just happening because it's kindled all the time because of Russia is kind of supporting some people on the eastern border of Ukraine. Yeah? So I think this is kind of setting the scene. This is an important half player of this conflict. Yeah? So when we see when we look at conflicts just in general, there are some conflicts, like very severe conflicts, like IRA in Britain or in South Africa, where mediation and just talking and trying to overcome did work. Yeah? And if there was no need for, I mean, it looked like there was need for war, but finally it was solved without weapons. Yeah? The other conflicts, and a recent example is, for example, yes, in Syria, I think nobody is seriously considering negotiating with IS of a smaller caliphate or whatever. Yeah? So I think I'm very much for talks and for mediation, but I think sometimes there is a limit. Yeah? So I'm just wondering, what kind of conflict do you see here, and what's the strongest possible impact of mediation, which you're all very hard working on? What's the strongest possible impact for mediation? And perhaps is something else needed? For example, somebody mentioned Europe should kind of put a stronger foot on the ground and say what else can be done beyond just mediation, support of any other kind. Thank you.
Okay, I think we have one last question, Bill, please.
I wonder whether a neutrality could be a solution, that Ukraine doesn't join NATO and not join the EU, and could trade with the EU and trade with Russia, and so what fight for?
Okay, thank you. I think we have several questions on the geopolitical situation and also on the internal. I would ask perhaps then the Ukrainian to be the last one to round up, maybe.
Okay, I will start very short with NGOs. Maybe you can like, or somebody can like Soros or not, and so on. There are different views about Soros, what he's doing, but the fact is, if it's a Soros NGO, it's not a Soros NGO, it's still an NGO. So whatever Putin is doing in Russia, he's doing against the NGO. It's not important if this NGO is close to or financed by Soros or not. It's an NGO, so we have to accept it. And what Soros is doing, that's another thing. But Soros is also active also in other countries. And also, if you don't like Soros, we must name the fact that these NGOs financed by Soros help very much also the peace process in, for example, the Balkan region. So, also maybe I'm not a big friend of Soros, but I must say the fact is he helped the peace in the Balkans. So, whatever Putin is doing, also if it's just a Soros NGO, he's doing it against NGO. So, it's not important if it's Soros or not behind that.
I think most of the NGOs, at least from the outside or also from the inside, who are a bit critical, have big problems in Russia.
Yes, so it's not
Friedrich Ebert Stiftung or Konrad Adenauer or the Green Run, whatever.
We should mention Memorial. I think we cannot mention Memorial. It's a most important, and for you, I think you are a leftist person and supporting Putin because you think he has some association with leftist idea and because he is anti-Americanist.
It's not that simple. I just
okay, but to put
Putin
it short,
Putin has nothing to do with the left. Anyway.
Okay, but I just know when I'm hearing the question.
The last one anyway.
Okay, sorry. I just Memorial. Read about it. The most democratic NGO in Russia.
And the most
without centrist structure, huge, like a net.
I was asked about the shelling data, so I want to refer you to the OSCE daily updates of the monitoring mission to Ukraine.
Yeah, there are daily reports about that. You can receive it from the OSCE.
From the internet. You can just Google, and then you get the daily reports on fightings that are going on that are monitored.
Yeah.
Whatever question you want to answer.
Okay, thank you. I may not remember them all, but since you were looking at me talking about the like another different player that we need to think about in this macro, we could go into a long discussion about whether there is a player or there is not a player there. But what I will tell, based on the words that you have said, well, starting with the fact that we've used the term hybrid conflict and hybrid war already, and it's a recognized fact that it's not something that we've seen before, of course. And I fully agree with you, what you said, that if there will be no Russia on the scene, it will be a very different situation at all. So our work is rather track two rather than track one. I might be telling you that I haven't personally seen any European ambassador at the Maidan state going and promising people something like in economical sense. And most of what I was telling is that the passion of those people who were there were absolutely not related to economics. They were mostly in the level of values. And our work is basically to help Ukraine not be a puppet in this regard, to understand yourself and our aspirations and our values, develop this set, and then we can decide whether neutrality is a better way or not, and whether we should really go into alliance with somebody else or not. Still, since we are in Ukraine and we are Ukrainian organization, we believe that we need to work on this educational task. As the former mayor of Bogota sometimes ago said, when he became the mayor of the most criminalized city in the Colombia, well, he said, yes, we have millions of problems. The only thing that means is we have a classroom with 7 million population, and we need to educate these people. And then he was going into a shower and showing on the TV how you need to switch off the water pipe when you soap your head so that you don't lose a lot of water. So you can use media in many different ways. And by the way, I wanted to mention that quite recently at the Donbass Dialogue, they were also touching the media, having some journalists there and discussing why do we have this propaganda. You were constantly referring to propaganda. I would rather say it's not a propaganda. It was quite biased reporting. And the reason which they discovered is not that there is any censorship or there is any special policy that will force this media into biased reporting, but it's the outcome and the conclusion that the dialogue participants came to was that actually it's because the journalists themselves are biased and they also take position in this conflict. And they reported through their own perspective that they believe is true about this conflict. I guess that's my contribution.
Yes, thank you. As I want to give Yevgenia the last word, just a brief comment from my side because I want to moderate and not to
excuse me. Wait a minute. Would it be possible the Minsk to...
Wait a minute. You will have an answer then. We are not at the end. The picture of Maidan, very often represented also in Austria, is very, very wrong. There were some extremists, right-wing extremists with uniforms, whatever. There were a small minority. And it was highly exaggerated what it was. I met many people from the Maidan, especially in the time afterwards. There were many young people who just were fed up with the corruption of the old regime. And I know the old regime because I can always say it very publicly, that my political group in European Parliament, when Mr. Schulz was still president, but I was responsible as vice president, were trying to get some sort of a process of contact with the party of the region and to try to convince them to transform themselves in a social democratic party, which was absolutely impossible because, and I spoke with Yanukovych, with the prime minister, Azarov, Kluyev, and many other people. It was absolutely impossible. They were not ready to reform because they didn't want to lose their corrupted positions. And that was the reason why Maidan was happening, not to fight against Russia, or not because they had been paid by NATO. So this is the one element. There was a real the people were fed up with the system as it was. Secondly, yes, the Americans had their interests. I agree. But that does not justify somebody else to do an intervention like that one in Crimea. I was always arguing against American intervention as illegal in for example, in Iraq. And de facto, we would have to have sanction. When we sanction Russia, we would have to sanction U.S. and many other countries as well, what they did, including in Libya with the French and the British. So that is hypocrisy. But that does not justify in any way what Russia did and does still. So I think we have to see, and you mentioned Memorial. I know the people from Memorial. I met them several times. And they were not trying to change the regime. They just wanted to show the historical developments of what happened in the Stalinist period and afterwards in Russia. And that was not welcomed, and they were suppressed, and they were very much, nearly... You should put the question different. What kind of NGO Putin does not suppress and fight against? Of course, those who are in the sense of his policy. So we should be, not because the one are bad, justify the other. If Russia is bad, then it doesn't justify American intervention. If American intervention is bad, it doesn't justify the Russian intervention. And by the way, Ukraine is not the only country. Look to Transnistria, look to Georgia. So it's a model what is happening. Was it, coming back to the one question, was it good what we did in European Union or the West with Ukraine? Perhaps it was not clever. Perhaps it would have been clever to have to go in a more step-by-step process, more open dialogue, also with Russia. I'm very much for dialogue with Russia, because European security without Russia is impossible. And for me, neutrality is a concept which is especially suitable for at least for some time. But again, we should not mix what should be have done, what we should have done, and what should be possible with that it gives the right of another country just to intervene militarily and to take up Crimea. And even the fact that Crimea was Russia once and it was given by Khrushchev, there are agreements that Russia accepted Crimea to be part of Ukraine. So I only want to appeal, before you get the last word, of course, I only want to appeal to my Austrian friends, don't mix up that one unjustified action is justifying another unjustified action. No, it's not about you, but in general...
But you have to be in mind.
Yeah, yeah. But in general, very often that is coming, you know. We are now on the Russian side because what America did is wrong. I think as Austrians, we should, if we want neutral, we should condemn any unjustified action. I think that and any imperialist action. So that is my brief intervention I wanted to say to my friends. But now you have a... 1 hour to answer.
Thank you. It's a really big honor to be here and to take part in this discussion. I think it really happened because we all had some kind of different opinions about what is going on there. And yeah, I agree with you. I think a conclusion is, for us it's very important to divide different types of dialogues you are speaking about. When you were saying not everybody agreed here that we should create a new dialogue, it is not true. I think on this panel everybody thinks so. Just most of us don't think that the dialogue on the level of human rights and dialogue between different communities can really stop the war, which is not based on the absence of such kind of the dialogue. Yes, and it doesn't mean that the dialogue should not take place. Question is, who is the partner of this dialogue? Old Greek philosopher, philosopher Epictetus, who was also a slave, who knows therefore lots of oppression, he was saying that not the situation itself is influencing other people, but the story about the situation is influencing other people. And it's always important who is telling the story and how the story is told to make other people understanding, to make other people understand the situation. And yes, and therefore I think we should pay attention to the people who are silent today, who are not representing represented on podium discussions, who are really witnessing the war. These people are very seldom in the news reports because everyday life is not an issue for news. And these people are very often living in the places where journalists are just not there, in small villages and small cities. And I think dialogue, really important dialogue, which you want to develop, or we lots of people here maybe are working on, the dialogue with people who are not able to speak publicly, or they can have no, they don't know how to go to the sphere where they can speak about their rights. Dialogue will also mean a platform that is built for them and make them possible, for them possible to speak. This dialogue is very needed and important for Ukraine, and I would personally support everybody who would work in that direction.
Still, Minsk, you have to answer in some way. What? Because otherwise,
I think it is a beautiful end.
I can try with the Minsk if you
please
want. Basically, and I will probably combine even two questions, both the Minsk agreements. The Minsk platform is basically, at the moment, I've heard it many times from many different people, is maintained as the only platform that really opens an opportunity for discussion and dialogues and certain decisions made there. It's unfortunately not very popular among the people, and it's not very well informed the way the negotiations take place there and what kind of compromises people are making in order to have at least some agreements that sometimes impact the conflict and how it goes. As it will have been asked, who should be the parties of the dialogue and what might be the results and the outcomes of it? And I would here agree with Yevgenia that, of course, whoever is participating in the dialogue is important to be a participant of this process. And being the mediator and the dialogue facilitator myself, I should tell you, whenever you think that you have the outcome in your head, forget it immediately, because if you will start pushing the process towards something that you believe is right, you will destroy it. I don't know what the outcome might be. It depends on the participants and the people who will be part of this dialogue. So, and I think the more opportunities we may create for the process, the better.
So that was also a nice end, or you would agree? Thank you very much. Yes, you can applaud. Thank you very much for coming. Three of you came from Kiev, more or less, and one from Belgrade, and you meet here in Vienna. That's very good. Some of you live also in Vienna, and I think it was a part of a process we want to establish in the sense of the dialogue, what you said, without knowing the outcome, and without trying to impose any kind of outcome. Thank you, good night, and
thank you for me.